This program is being presented to you by the Heraeus International Winter School on Gravity and Light.
Hello and welcome back to the sixth tutorial of the WE Heraeus International Winter School on Gravity and Light. Today's topic, fields. Again, we will start with a few true or false questions as exercise one. So, A. A bundle is uniquely determined by its base space and its total space. Well, we recall the definition of a bundle. It consists of a base space M, a total space E, and I write TM because our bundles will always be this TM. And, importantly, a projection, which maps from TM into M. This projection is not mentioned here, so this statement is wrong. It is wrong. Why did I think it? A bundle consists of a smooth manifold and an injective map to a topological manifold. This is true. This is also wrong, because this surjection, this projection, was defined as being surjective. So, injective is wrong. It may be injective. We don't know, but it has to be surjective. A bundle gives rise to the notion of fibers. This is certainly true, because we define the fiber as the pre-image of this projection of a point P. So our bundle setting gives rise to this notion, right? A bundle projection P has open pre-images in the total space if fed with open sets in the base space. This is just the definition of continuity of a map between topological spaces, and the bundle map has to be smooth, or we required it to be smooth, and smooth also means continuous, so this is true. A bundle allows to define a section sigma from the base space into the total space that has to fulfill this identity. Sigma after pi is the identity map on TM. Well, this is not quite true, because a section, it's right, it was defined as a map from M into TM, but this map has to fulfill pi after sigma is the identity on M. So this is the other way around, and here it then has to say identity on M. So no, this is false. Question B. The total space of a tangent bundle over a smooth manifold M is constructed by intersecting all tangent spaces TPM. Well, the bad word here is of course intersecting. The definition of the tangent bundle was that we take the union, which is disjoint, over all points in the manifold of the tangent spaces. So union, not intersection. This total space has double the dimension of the base space. This is right. In the lectures, you constructed an atlas for the total space and saw that it was of dimension 2 times the dimension of the base space. So yes. The total space carries an atlas inherited from the atlas of M. This is also right, because this atlas I talked about was built from an atlas of M. So right. The total space is the target space of a smooth vector field. Again, this is red, because the vector field was just, by definition, such a section which is a map from M into the total space Tm, which also happens to be smooth. So vector fields are by definition smooth sections from M into Tm. So the target space, so the total space is the target space of a smooth vector field. The total space contains only tangent vectors. Right. As you can readily see here in the definition of the total space. These tangent spaces contain only tangent vectors, so the union of tangent spaces contains only tangent vectors. Question C. A tensor field on a smooth manifold M is a C-infinity M linear map. Right, as you can see in the definition of a tensor field. A tensor field was just a map from copies of the smooth sections on the cotangent bundle. So here, copies of gamma of T star M and of copies of smooth sections on the tangent bundle. Into C infinity of M. And this is in a C infinity M multilinear manner. So C infinity M multilinear. So in order to be very precise, we'd have to specify multilinear here. But we'll check it. Tensor field of valence Rs sends R covector fields and S vector fields to a smooth function. This is also right, because by definition of a tensor field of valence Rs, we take here R copies of gamma of T star M, which contains exactly the covector fields, and S copies of gamma of Tm, which are exactly the vector fields, and map them multilinearly into the smooth functions. So right. A tensor field on a smooth manifold M can be added to another tensor field on the same manifold. Of course, in order to be able to talk about multilinearity, we have to have a notion of addition, which we can establish point-wise, because these are fields which get eaten, and this is a function, so we can look at tensor fields at one point. There we have ordinary tensor spaces, and there we can add and subtract and divide and multiply by scalars. And this carries on to a certain extent to tensor fields. But here we are C infinity of M multilinear, so you have to be careful. You cannot no longer divide by any function. Right. A tensor field on a smooth manifold M is a smooth function if it is of valence 0, 0. Yes, this is true. Just by definition. If R and S happen to be 0, here we still understand a 0 infinity of M. And then we have a smooth function. A tensor field on a smooth manifold M has as its components R plus S to the dim M many smooth functions with respect to a chart. Well, this is not correct. This here has to be the other way around. We have dimension of M to the R plus S, because the component functions were T I1 until IR down J1 until JR, each running from 1 to dimension of M, yielding in total dimension of M to the R plus S. Exercise 2. vector fields for practitioners. Question. Let UX be a chart of a smooth manifold, M or A, and explain why this map, which is given here, is a vector field on U. So what does this map do? It takes a point and gives this basis vector with respect to the chart X at the point P, which lies in TPM. So why is this assignment a vector field? Well, what is a vector field? They are smooth sections. Smooth sections. So we have to check whether the projection after the section yields the identity on the manifold. So for our problem here, we have to check whether the projection of this vector field at the point P yields again P. So we can calculate this. This is just by definition exactly this vector. So we have pi of this vector del xi P. And what does pi do? Well, pi is the projection and it assigns to each vector in Tm its base point. This is how you constructed a tangent bundle. And the base point of this vector here is this P, which is denoted down here. So this just gets P. So we checked that pi after del xi indeed is just the identity of M, because it takes a point P and gets a point P. So right, this is a vector field. Well, right, this is a section at first. Now we have to check for smoothness of the section. So a vector field maps from M, so here because it is defined with respect to a chart, only from a subset of M, from U, into Tm, here Tu. Those are both differentiable manifolds, so differentiability or smoothness we can only decide on the chart level. And therefore we have to employ two charts. One chart here, which is already given. This is chart X. And here this inherited chart, Xi X. Right. And for smoothness, we'll have to check whether the composition is smooth. So here X inverse and here Xi X, whether this is smooth. So let's do this. First we calculate, so we'll insert a point in RD and check what this composition of maps does with RD in order to decide whether this map on RD is smooth or not. So we have Xi X of del or del X I of X inverse of an element of RD. So of tuples alpha 1 to alpha D. Right? Now, this vector field Also, this vector field is defined here. If we plug in this x inverse of our numbers, we just get the vector del for del x I at the point x inverse of these numbers. Now we have to evaluate the chart map for TU at this point in TU. What did this chart map do? Well, the first D entries were just the coordinates of the base point down here and the chart map X. So here it are just the numbers alpha 1 until alpha D. Now the next D entries were the components of this vector in the chart X. And because this already is a basis vector in the chart X, we just have zeros and a 1 at the D plus ith position, because it is the ith basis vector. Now, this is a map from RD into R2D, and of course it is smooth, because here it just reproduces those numbers, and here we get a 1. You can very easily say that this is smooth. So we checked on the chart level whether this map is smooth, and because we have smooth atlases on both of these manifolds, the whole map is smooth. So this is not only a section, but also a smooth section. So, yes, it is a vector field. Now, next question. Now we have to show this Leibniz rule for smooth functions and for these differential geometric derivatives. Let us start by identifying what these objects are. Well, first, these are functions in C infinity of M, and this is the pointwise multiplication on C infinity of M. You just get a new function by multiplying both values. So again here, we have functions and this was a vector field. And we defined in the lectures the application rule for a vector field on a function. What this shall be. So, this is a vector field, it's a section gamma of Tm. What did it do? Well, the application of a vector field on functions was defined this way. It gives a function, and if we evaluate this function at a point P, we just get the vector field at the point P applied at the function, because This gives a vector, and a vector we may apply to a function. This defines our application rule of vector fields on functions. So, this whole object on the left side is a function according to this application rule, as well as this and this are functions. Now, after we identified all this, we may really calculate this formula, starting at the left-hand side. And we will do this by evaluating this function at a point. So, del xi of f times g at a point p is defined by our application rule as this vector field at the point p acting on the functions f times g. Now, this vector field was really defined by taking the values del x I p, these vectors. We apply them to the functions f times g. Well, this has a definition which we recalled in the last problem sheet. This is the ith partial derivative of this function after the inverse of the coordinate map and evaluated at the chart image of the point P. So, now this looks very much like we could apply a product rule, but not yet. First, we have to see whether what we can make out of the combination of this circ and this dot. So let us first forget about this del I and look at a function of this kind. On a side note. So, here we have something like f times g after x inverse of x of p. So this is, by definition of the circle, f times g of x inverse of x of p. This we may just leave, we don't need to cancel it. Now, this multiplication we defined up here is just the pointwise multiplication. So we can insert this point into each of both functions and we get f of x inverse of x of p times g of x inverse of x of p. So we see this really breaks down to the pointwise product, or after inserting, to the product on the real numbers. So this distributes over this dot. And we may apply the product rule. So we get the derivative of f after x inverse at x of p times g of x inverse of x of p plus f of x inverse of x of p times del I g after x inverse of x of p. Now these just are g of p and f of p, and these are our symbols. You may translate them back into del f over del xi at the point p, here g of p, plus f of p times here del g over del xi at the point p. And since this holds for every point P, we showed this rule. Now turning to the next question. Here, we are asked to expand the vector field chi on the domain of a chart U and X in terms of component functions. Chi I in C infinity of M. Well, first we can look at how a vector expands. So you may take this vector field chi at the point P, which is a vector, and may expand it with respect to this chart. So we get components chi of p with respect to the chart, ith component, and multiply it with this ith basis vector with respect to this chart at the point p. Now, this is just a vector field evaluated at the point P, the vector field which was defined up here. So we may denote it like this, del xi at the point P. And now we see, we can drop this point P and regard this number we get, well, this numbers we get at any point P just as a function of P, the component functions, and this as a vector field. And this is the expansion of a vector field on the chart domain U of X, because this expansion, of course, we can only do in the chart domain if P lies in the chart domain. So the next question. By application to chi of which core vector field does one obtain the component functions x, chi, y? Well, again, we may look at how we can extract at every point these components. You already know how this goes. Just have chi P I X is just the gradient of this coordinate function at the point P applied to the vector chi of P of which you want to extract the component. And the gradient at the point P you can consider as a section in the, so as a section gamma t star in gamma t star m, a section in the cotangential bundle. So here in this expression we can drop the p have here the covector field dxi and apply it on the vector chi. Exercise 3. The cotangent bundle T star M mapping to M with the projection pi. This question, this exercise, is about constructing an atlas for the cotangent bundle just like you constructed an atlas for the tangent bundle during the lectures. Therefore, we consider the cotangent bundle as just like the tangent bundle defined with the total space T star M being the disjoint union of cotangent spaces at any point, every point. The projection map just maps an covector out of the cotangent bundle to its unique base point P. Now we want to show that we can equip the cotangent bundle with a topology just by taking the pre-images of open sets on the base space as open sets in the cotangent space. This is written here. The topology on the cotangent space shall just consist of those sets . Now, in order for this set to be a topology, there are three conditions which have to hold. The first condition is that the empty set is contained in the topology. So, how do we check this? Well, in order to check this, we just have to see that the pre-image under the map pi of the empty set, which is just the set of every point omega in the total space, which gets projected into the base space and yields and lies in the empty set. So pi of omega shall be contained in the empty set. But of course, since pi is a map, every point in T star M gets mapped onto something, so nothing lands in the empty set, which means that the pre-image of the empty set is empty as well. So the pre-image, so the empty set, is contained in this topology we constructed. Now we have to check the same for the total space, for T star M, whether it lies in the topology or not. For this, we consider the pre-image under the map pi of the total space. Well, no, of the whole base space. And this shall be any element in the total space whose projection lies in the base space. And since the projection was defined as a map from T star M into M, this condition is always true. Every pi of omega is an element of M, obviously. This condition is always true, so here we just collect every element of T star M. And we see that there's an open set whose pre-image is whole T star M, an open set in the topology on the base space. So the total space is contained in the topology on the total space we constructed. Now, for the second condition, we have to start with two sets in O T star M and have to check whether their intersection also is contained in O of T star M. So, what does this mean, having two maps in O T star M? Well, it means there are two sets, lowercase u and v, in the topology of M, whose preimages, another map pi, yield uppercase U and uppercase V. Well, now we can consider the union of those two sets. Let me write it this way. So the union consists of all elements in T star M who lie in U and in V, so such that omega is contained in U and omega is contained in V. Now we can rewrite U and V as the preimages of open sets on M. So these are elements omega who are contained in the preimage, another map pi, of small u, and in the preimage under pi small v. Now we can evaluate this condition by the very definition of the preimage. Omega is contained in the preimage under the map pi of u if pi of u, if pi of omega is contained in u. So you can write this this way, omega and t star m, such that pi of omega is contained in u and pi of omega is also contained in v. So this condition in total means that pi of omega is contained in the intersection of lowercase u and lowercase v, which means omega is contained in the preimage, another number pi, of the sets u and v, of the intersection of the sets u and v. And since we collect all those sets, we showed that the intersection of uppercase u and v is just the preimage, another projection of the intersection of the generating sets lowercase u and v, which by the definition of a topology on an N on M, we are provided with a topology, are also open sets on M. And this shows that for two sets U and V in O T star M, the intersection is also contained in O T star M. Now, the third property follows analogously. Now we consider a collection of sets in O of T star M, so collection UI, where I is contained in some index sets, and the UI are contained in O of T star M. Well, again we can rephrase this, as there exists a collection lowercase ui is in some index set where every ui is contained in the topology of M, such that their preimages are contained are exactly uppercase UI. Right? Just like above, but now for a collection over some arbitrary index set. And again, we consider now the union. Not U for union. Over the whole index set of Archhausen sets UI. Well, what is this? By definition, these are, well, let's take a different approach to this. We look at an element in this union. And what does it mean for an element to be in this union? Well, it means it is contained in one of those sets, at least. So there exists an I such that omega is contained in this map capital UI. Well, this we can evaluate because we know what UI looks like. UI is just the preimage under the map pi of lowercase UI. So there exists an I in the index set such that omega is contained in the preimage of the projection pi of lowercase UI. Well, and again, this is just the condition that pi of omega is contained in lowercase UI. What does this mean? There exists one set in this one index in this index set such that this condition holds. Well, that means that omega that pi of omega is contained in the union over the whole index set. So pi of omega is contained in the union of those lowercase UIs over the whole index set. Well, and this means that the preimage that omega is contained in the preimage with respect to the map pi of the union over the index set of lowercase UIs. And we know, since OM is a topology, that this also is an OM. So this in total is some open set in OT star M. And since this holds for any omega, and these are equivalence arrows, we can conclude that the union over the whole index set of these UIs is just the preimage under the map pi of the union of the lowercase UIs, which is open. So this is in T, this is in O, T star M. So indeed, O T star M constitutes a topology. Now we want to provide a chart map on T star M, which we construct from a chart map on M, just like we did in a lecture for the tangent bundle. The idea is the same. Just say that our manifold looks like this circle here, then our tangent bundle consists of all tangent spaces at this circle, So this collection would be our bundle, and we can, well, now it's the cotangent bundle. And if we pick an omega, like from here out of the cotangent bundle, we can project it down to the base point. So this is omega, this is the base point pi of omega. And the idea for the atlas is to take the components in the chart X on M as the first D components, and then the components of these covector as the second D components. So it goes like this. We pick an omega in T star M and assign to it a tuple of real numbers, of 2 dim M real numbers. And as I said, the first ones are just the components of the base point with respect to the chart X we chose. So components of the base point means X after pi, pi projects down to the base point of our omega. First component until the dth component. So D shall of course denote the dimension of the manifold. Now for the second D components, we take the components of this covector omega in the by X induced basis on the cotangent space at the point P. How could we extract them? Well, we just have to act with omega on the basis vector del x1 at the point, at the base point, so at pi of omega, and this goes until omega of del over del x d, the base point pi of omega. Well, this we could call omega, the shorthand notation for this is omega in the chart X and the first component, for example. Well, this is the chart map. Now we have to find the inverse of such a chart map. Well, what does the inverse do? It maps from the target space, so from R to D, to the domain, so to T star U now. So we feed it with a collection of real numbers with, let's call them alpha 1 to alpha d, d numbers, and the other numbers, let's call them omega 1 and omega d, 2d numbers, and we assign to them by this map an element of T star U. And which element of T star U? Well, of course, we have to reconstruct a covector. And we have to reconstruct the covector in the space TP star U. So here we get a covector in the space TP star U, where P has to be reconstructed from the first D numbers, which are just the components of a point in the chart X. So P is the inverse map of these numbers, and this will yield a point in the manifold in the base space. And the second, so the base point is this, and the components are then just given by the next D collection of numbers, so omega 1 to omega D. And we know how to build a covector out of its components. We just have to multiply these components with the basis elements, so with D, X, I, sub P, and P we also reconstructed as X inverse of alpha 1 until alpha D. This is our inverse map. We get those collection of numbers, and from this collection of numbers we get the base point and the components of the covector, which lies in the cotangent space at this base point. Now we have to check whether the transition maps with respect to two different charts on M are continuous or are smooth in order to have a smooth atlas, of course. So such a transition map will again be fed with a collection of real numbers, give an element in the total space, and then again give a collection of real numbers, but now with respect to a different chart map Y. So at first we have to reconstruct our covector like above, just by multiplying these components, which are called gamma down here, gamma I, with the basis elements D, X, I, and the base point gets reconstructed from the alphas, alpha 1 to alpha D. Now we have a chart map which gets a covector, and have now to give the coordinates of the base point with respect to the Y chart and the components of the covector here with respect to the Y chart also. So what are the coordinates of the base point? Well, it's just the chart map acting on the base point here. So get y after x inverse 1 of the alphas until y after x inverse d of our alphas. So this constitutes the first dim M numbers. Now for the second dim M numbers we have to consider the components of this covector in the Y chart, and this is very easy knowing that these numbers here are components in the X chart, and our tensor transformation law tells us how to get the components in the Y chart, right? Therefore we have to reconsider this tensor transformation law, which went like this. Components in the Y chart, you get by these objects, by del x, components of covectors, of course written downstairs. We get del x j, well, del y I at the point P, at the base point, I will denote it by P for here, and then the components in the X chart. This is the transformation law for the components of covectors. So here we have now del x j over del y 1. The point P is the base point. X inverse of alpha 1 to alpha d. And this goes until del x j. Well, I forgot. I forgot, of course, here the omega xj. This goes until del xj over del yd with the base point times the omega xj. And we are done. Well, now we have to check, well, now for the next question, we have to check whether this map is smooth. This map which assigns two dim m real numbers to two dim m other real numbers. For the first half, this is quite easy to see, because these are just chart transition maps on the base manifold, and those are smooth because we consider only smooth manifolds. So the smoothness of the first D components is clear. Now the second D components are linear combinations of our omega xj, and I forgot to say something, omega xj I denoted with the components of the covector in the x chart, and these were just the gamma 1 until gamma dim m which enter the calculation here. So I really should have written down gamma 1, a gamma j here. So these are called gamma j for us here. And we see we just have a linear combination of these gamma j's with these numbers. But watch out, here in these numbers the alphas enter, so it remains to check that these objects are smooth. So this we have to check. But it is seen very quickly, because we just have to recall the definition of this, and this was del 1, for example, for the first one, del 1 of xj after y evaluated at y of x of alpha 1 until alpha d. And here it says x inverse. And this is just a composition of smooth functions. Here we have a transition map, which is smooth. And here we also have a transition map with a smooth, which gets differentiated one time, but of course still remains smooth. So this is smooth. So second d components of this map are smooth as well. And we constructed us a smooth atlas of dimension 2d, so we can conclude that the cotangent bundle is a smooth manifold of dimension 2d. This concludes the sixth exercise cheat. See you next time.